Over 4,000 miles away from the borders of the United States, a few miles outside of the Brazilian city of Sao Paulo, is an annual festival of the Fraternity of American Descendants, where the old Confederate flag flies and the battle songs of the Confederacy blast on. The Brazilian government funds the movement, where children fly Confederate flags, buy printed out Confederate currency, and even the mayor of this modest town comes out to join in the festivities. Flying over to the USA, these residents would find the stigma and feelings of aggression attached to the Confederacy and Confederate flags to be quite perplexing. Americana is the name of this Brazilian city, founded by former Confederate soldiers that escaped the United States after the end of the American Civil War. And although not all in the town are descended from these Confederates, nearly all take part in the festival, including many native Brazilians of African or mixed race descent. So how in the world did a Confederate town end up in the middle of South America? As many know, the American Civil War was one of the bloodiest and costliest of any war in history, not in terms of total death and damage wrought, but when comparing proportionally with around 1 million Americans dead out of a population of 30 million in the time span of 4 years. For perspective, that'd be proportional to if 2.5 9/11s occurred every single day in the United States for 4 years in the modern age. Families were ripped apart, hundreds of thousands of women were widowed, thousands of children orphaned, and although many positive consequences resulted from the war as well, such as freeing of all African slaves and granting all non-whites citizenship in the United States, it's no wonder that so many people feel such strong feelings about the war and the parties involved, despite anyone from even remotely around that time period being long dead. For the most part, these feelings are passed down from generation to generation, relaying the horrors and atrocities that civilians from both sides had to endure. With the closing of the Civil War, the American federal government did everything in its power to stamp out the legacy of the Confederacy, which fought for slavery, anti-federalism, and the reduction of government powers, sending their own Republican representatives for each state for a duration during the Reconstruction era, and were administered as territories before individually being accepted back into the Union. And because of Lincoln's desire for a speedy reunion of these rebel states, he decreed that only 10% of the electorate of each state would need to declare loyalty to the Union in order to be admitted as a state. This left a huge proportion of Southerners embittered and resentful of the Northern government, and although virtually all Southern states voted as a bloc for the Democratic candidate, with not one single Southern state voting Republican until 1920, because their population was only half that of the non-Southern states, they failed to make any major strides in representation in the federal government for decades after the Civil War. Because so many Southern plantation owners and even non-slave-owning farmers had their properties looted, burned down, and desecrated during the war, many acted out in violence, targeting and terrorizing the newly emancipated black slaves, being unable or unwilling to compete in the open job market with the freedmen. This led many Southern farmers, as well as former Confederate soldiers, to set their eyes upon new lands in which they could dominate, with scouting parties being sent out by Southern envoys before the war even ended. Many historians argue that the Confederacy was always destined to lose the Civil War, being heavily outmanned, lagging behind at least 2 decades technologically, with only 56% of Southern whites knowing how to read, compared to 97% of Northern whites in 1860, and the Union had some of the best military minds in the world at their disposal, with veterans of the Mexican-American War and even the War of 1812 serving in their ranks. The Confederacy, of course, knew these hurdles and planned on beating the Union, not through might, but through strategy, planning on greatly expanding its borders and influence, but not through gaining more U.S.-American territory, but through annexing chunks of Latin America directly to their south. Southerners funded many attempts at destabilization and revolution in Latin American countries, particularly Mexico, where Americans such as William Walker were able to conquer and rule over vast expanses of territory in northern Mexico with such small forces, considering that the northern stretches of the country were virtually depopulated at the time. Walker established a government in La Paz in 1853, which was years before the start of the American Civil War, declaring himself president and ruling over the areas of Baja California and Sonora for only a few months before the Mexican government sent troops to depose the American invader. Walker planned on gaining widespread American support for the annexation of the unrecognized Republic of Sonora as an additional slave state in the southern U.S., but he never managed to gain federal support, although he was quite popular among Californians at the time. Walker attempted another shot at annexing northern Mexico with the Republic of Lower California in Baja California, but was again thwarted by Mexican authorities and fled even further south to Central America, where he took advantage of the ongoing Nicaraguan Civil War and, with only a small posse, managed to overthrow the government of the entire country, once again declaring himself president of Nicaragua and effectively ruled over the Central American country for almost a year before being captured by Honduran and British authorities and thus put an end to the self-proclaimed president of three countries. And Walker was executed in 1860, right before the onset of the American Civil War. Further attempts at American expansionism and imperialism by Southerners continued, with colonists moving in small numbers to places like Chihuahua in northern Mexico and British Honduras, now known as Belize. Although none of these ventures proved successful for the South, shortly before and during the Civil War, Confederate strategists seriously considered the option of invading and annexing Mexico, Central America, and the entirety of the Caribbean if they were able to declare victory or even simply a ceasefire with the northern government, planning on re-enslaving the black Caribbean population and encouraging mass migration from places like England, France, and Germany in order to build a new society envisioned as being a golden circle encircling the Caribbean. The end of the war in 1865 put an end to any realistic plans of mass conquest of Latin America by Confederate forces. However, members of the Knights of the Golden Circle, a pro-Confederate paramilitary organization, with members including Samuel Mudd and John Wilkes Booth, the assassin of Abraham Lincoln, still held on to hope of being able to establish a future Confederate empire or establishing colonies in other parts of the Americas. They funded and helped fund the passage of thousands of Southern farmers and Confederate fugitives wanted for war crimes out of the recently unified United States into Latin America, although major Confederate figures such as General Robert E. Lee and former President Jefferson Davis strongly discouraged the Southerners from fleeing from their homeland, wishing for them to instead remain in the South and aid in rebuilding Southern infrastructure and cooperate with Northern authorities. These immigrants, although they were American, were loyal to the Confederacy and saw themselves as Confederates first, reveling in the ways of the Old South in the antebellum period before the war. These immigrants made their way first to Mexico, where they were welcomed by Austrian-Mexican Emperor Maximilian and were given land and Mexican citizenship. Although directly after the overthrow of Emperor Maximilian, these portions of land and citizenship were revoked, and the Confederate colonists were expelled from the country, and unsurprisingly, these Southerners opted to travel even further south. In November of 1865, the first Americans entered the port of Rio de Janeiro in Brazil, which at the time was also under the rule of an emperor known as Dom Pedro II. Emperor Dom Pedro wished to push Brazil, which was at the time seen as very backwards and rooted in poverty, into the modern world like the United States and Europe, and saw the Confederates, who were given the exonym Confederado, as a potentially huge boost to the economy of Brazil, which had a climate that was comparable to the southern United States and still allowed for the practice of slavery until the year 1888. The Confederados mostly settled around large cities such as Sao Paulo and Rio de Janeiro, and eventually their numbers became stable enough to establish their own city known as Americana. Around 10 to 20,000 Confederados settled in Brazil, coming from states such as Alabama, Texas, Georgia, Louisiana, and Mississippi, and brought with them the unique aspects of Southern American culture from the establishment of the Southern Baptist Church in Brazil to Southern fried chicken. Many of the Americans returned home after the end of the Reconstruction era. However, many took Brazilian citizenship, learning Portuguese, taking on Brazilian culture, and even occasionally intermarrying with the Brazilian population. The city of Americana today has greatly expanded following an influx of Italian, German, and Brazilian migrants from other areas of Brazil, and now numbers over 200,000 people, being located only 100 kilometers away from Sao Paulo. Although no one knows exactly how many Confederado descendants are in Brazil today, they certainly number well into the tens of thousands. That is, tens of thousands of people that not only see themselves as having Brazilian and American heritage, but Confederate as well, leading to the large Confederate celebration in Americana, where not only Confederados, but Brazilians of all ethnic, racial, and national backgrounds can attend. White supremacist and racist iconography is strictly forbidden from entering the festivals, with guards searching for swastika or KKK tattoos on visitors, all the while sporting shirts, shorts, hats, and flags brandishing the flag of the former Confederacy. In fact, because of intermarriage, many of the Confederados themselves are of mixed race, and although they do recognize that the Confederacy fought to preserve slavery and racism, they see their flag and traditions as being reminiscent of their heritage and culture. And with even the multiracial Brazilian government tolerating and even encouraging such displays, it certainly is hard to argue against that, seeing how although the flag has been used to terrorize and intimidate black Americans in the U.S. for years, the Confederados have only ever used the flag in celebration, which just goes to show that even out of the most horrific movements can emerge something unique and interesting that anyone can take part in. Go ahead and let me know your thoughts on the American Civil War, the American adventurers that attempted to annex Latin America, and the Confederados of Brazil and their usage of the Confederate flag. As always, thanks for watching, everyone. It's been Mason, and the South will rise again. I'll see you next time.